We are swift to give honor to our heavenly Father, Yahweh, to his Son, our elder brother, Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, and to the blessed Holy Spirit. Good to be in the house of the Lord. One more time. We didn't have to do it, but I'm so glad. Amen. Amen. There is a word today coming from Ephesians. Thank God for our hymn choir. And you know, we just thank God that he allows you to be able to have the strength and the ability to go ahead and lift up his songs too. Be able to stomp your feet, clap your hands, and open your mouth and give him the praise. Amen. Amen. He is so worthy of it all. Ephesians, the second chapter. Ephesians, the second chapter. And let us stand for the reading of God's word. Ephesians, the second chapter. Beginning at verse 1 to verse number 10.
And you have he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Yeah. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Amen. Amen.
May the Lord add a blessing to the hearer, to the reader, but above all to the doers of his written word. I want to come primarily out of that fourth verse, but God. Who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. Verse 5 says, even when we were dead in sins, have quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved. That about how your Bible reads? I want to preach by aid of the Holy Spirit for just a few minutes in your hearing a sermon. Don't forget where God brought you from. Don't forget where God brought you from. It's homecoming. And in homecoming, you need to be reminded of some things from time to time. And this year, I don't want you to forget where God has brought you from. Let us pray. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Lord, we pray right now that you would open our eyes that we may see Jesus trying to work in our lives. Then, Lord, open up our ears that we may hear a word from you. But Lord, don't stop there. Open up our hearts that your word may be safely lost in the repository thereof. That no matter where we are, your word will rise up and help us to meet every occasion. This, O God, is our humble prayer. And it is in Jesus' name that we do pray. And as God's children, we say, Amen. You may be seated in the presence of an Almighty God. Don't forget where God brought you from. Sometimes we can get to the place that we want to say it like somebody else need to remember where God brought them from. Sometimes we'll go about and make it our business to spread the word about where people were in their life. Sometimes we end up with a bad habit of going around and reminding people of what they used to be. And sometimes we rehearse it so good till we make it look like that's what they still are today. And I want us to understand that all of us fall into the same category written over there in Romans where it tells us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now look up here because I don't want you to miss it. If you're swimming and you're over here, and you trying to get here to the shore, look up here. It don't matter if you drown here. It don't matter if you drown here, or if you drown here, or even right here. You still shore. What you trying to say, Reverend? My mess may not be as bad as your mess. My mess may be worse than your mess. But if you don't get with Jesus, we all will still fall short. Am I helping somebody already? We need to come to Jesus. And for those of us that come to Jesus already, we need to make sure that we don't walk around like we got it all together. We don't need to walk around like we don't worry about anything anymore, like we don't go through any problems, or we just got it all together and we've been saved as soon as we come out the womb. We want to let folks know just because we got it, we don't deserve it just like you don't. Am I right about it? I was just like you. I was shaped in iniquity in my mother's womb. And so we got to realize that you are either one or the other. Either you have accepted Christ or you haven't accepted Christ. And you know, it's possible to be going around in this world and feeling just because you are walking around that you are all right. Sometimes Peter talks about it over in the epistles of Peter, where he talks about how you have people that will be going around when the last days come talking about, we've been talking about Jesus coming back ever since I can remember. And is he really coming back? I ain't seen him yet. But the Bible says, and I'm paraphrasing, one day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. What you're trying to say, just because he ain't came back yet, don't mean he ain't coming back. And you can't on that day be getting ready to be ready. Have I got a witness in this place? See, because before the muscles around your lips get a chance to make O, let alone before your mouth on the inside can form and breath come past your tongue and your teeth to get the word out, oh, it'll be over. Because it's going to happen in the twinkling of an eye. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are left shall be caught up to be with the Lord. But while we're waiting on that, it's important that we don't forget where God has brought us from. Am I right about it? We need to be remembered where God has brought us from. And you know, if you've been reading in the devotionals that I've been sending out, we're dealing with Ephesians, the second chapter. And Charles Spurgeon, among many others, have wrote some things to help us out just a little bit. And he dealt with situation like, you've got to understand there's all kinds of life. There's vegetable life, and there's animal life, and there's mental life, and there's moral life. But the one that is above all is spiritual life. And you see, a spiritual being might be alive in one sense, but a human being may be alive in one sense, but dead in another. You see, there was a gentleman that bought a pharmaceutical company, and there was a drug at the time that ran about $13 a drug. And he saw an opportunity to make money behind that drug and jack the price up to $750 a pill, a 5,000% markup. And he recently went to trial for something else, but you know, it's amazing that if one thing don't get you, if you ain't living right, something else will come along and still mess you up. Can I get a witness in here? And you know, it's possible to be walking around and not have a connection with God. And you say, how can you know you not have a connection with God? Because of the simple fact, when you got a connection with God, your fruit is going to speak. And if you got a connection with the devil, your fruit is going to speak. This man walking around in greed because of the simple fact that he cares more about money than he does about the lives of any cancer patient or any AIDS patient. And he jacked the price up to where it has gone, the treatment, from about $1,000 a year now to almost $60,000 a year for the same treatment. My brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that you can be walking around in this life when you are not connected with God, and you can think you have it going on and be well on your way to hell. Can I get a witness in this place? You got to make sure that you come on out from the darkness and begin to walk in the marvelous light. Well, I mean, the text is here to help us to understand in this second chapter of Ephesians. And look there at verse 1. It says, and you have he quickened. But notice where you was in that next part. It says, who were dead in trespasses and sins. And I stopped by on my way to heaven to let somebody know today, it doesn't matter where you've been. It matters that as I preach the other Sunday, from now on, that you make up your mind that you're going to go in the direction that God wants you to go. Because all of us, when we look back on our lives, we were dead in trespasses and sins. Verse 2 says, wherein in times past, that's the key word, time past. In other words, here I used to be like that. I used to do that. But from now on,
there's a difference in my life. And I want somebody to remember, don't forget where God has brought you from. Because in times past, we walked according to the prince of the powers of the air. And we were by nature children of disobedience. In other words, on this Sunday, I want somebody to look back over your life and see that the Lord has brought you from a mighty long way. We had our conversation, our lifestyle. We had all kind of things going on. And I want you to realize that you may not have been one that went out and drunk every night. You may not have been one that has ever smoked a cigarette. But I want you to realize that no matter how far you were, you were still short. And don't you dare forget that God, whether you were born from right here, brought from right here all the way over to here, the Lord has brought you from a mighty long way. Can I get a witness that God, even though we used to be in the hell, the wrath of God upon our lives, and even though we went about doing everything we were big and bad enough to do, I'm so glad that we're the play where it said, but God, who was rich in mercy, I'm so glad that while I didn't have enough sense to come to him, he sent a word to me and you. And somewhere down the line, we accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. Am I right about it? We believe that they hung him high, and they spread him wide, and he died for your sins and for mine. But early on a Sunday morning, that he got up, I said he got up with all power in his hand. Am I right about it? But God, who was rich in mercy, and I'm so glad that mercy was extended to me and you. Is there anybody here that's enjoying the mercy of God? Is there anybody here that realizes that grace suits your case? Grace is unmerited favor. Grace is something I don't deserve. Grace is something you don't deserve. If it had since that day. you, Lord. On this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not rise against it. Don't mean that some hell won't try to rise up in the church. Can I get a witness? Just means it won't prepare. That's New Testament. You look like an Old Testament, no weapon. They may have crowbars looking at you. Yeah, I'm gonna get you. And you may see them put it together, but it won't prosper. Won't work. And that's why Jesus went over there in the New Testament and put that piece in there about the gates of hell. The gates. The authorities. The powers. The principalities. Let me make it a little bit more plain. See, when you come into the body of Christ, you came as you were. And some need more surgery than others. Oh, I wish I could get some help with that. See, some of us stayed out there so long till we got sick in our head, sick in our heart. Like that young man I was telling you about. Won't jack drug prices up that high. No need. But if you end up staying out there, you can end up thinking like that. There was a show the other night talking about greed. And just showing about how greed-stricken people are. Let me tell you, money is a poor god. It's a poor god, because no matter how much you get, it won't be enough. You can chase that dollar if you want to. It won't be enough. You say, well, I'm not worried about money. Well, you can chase prestige. And you want to have honor and have your name mentioned. And you want to have all of this. The only name worth mentioning is Jesus. He's the only one that gives you the ability and the strength to gain wealth in the first place. So the one who gives you the ability to do that is more than anybody else. God is good, church. And the danger of coming in church and being in a long time, that's why it's homecoming, is you can get that mindset that I deserve it, I earned it. And you ought to be glad I'm here. You ought to be glad I showed up. You ought to be glad I volunteered. I'll go home if you don't do it the way I want it done. You didn't come here to serve Pierre. Any of the deacons, the deaconess, or any of the trustees, or any of the other officers. You came here for the same reason we came here should be, and that's to serve God. One who gives you breath. The one who gives you breath. The one who allows you to breathe every day. You need breath every day. And if anybody ever lost their breath for 1 second, it gets your attention right away. So the one who gives you the ability to breathe out and then allow it to come back, that's the one we're here for. Amen. The one who started your heart and one day it will stop, that's the one we're here for. And You need to remember him. Let us not forget where God brought us from. Let us stand. There could be someone here today that does not know Jesus Christ in the free pardon of your sins. And if that's you, the doors of the church are open. Now is the time for you to come. If you haven't accepted Christ, I want you to understand. If you can understand what I'm saying right now, whether you think it's fair or whether you think it's not, you are on your way to hell. It's just that plain and simple. But I got good news. He doesn't want you to go to hell. But he'll let you go to hell. But if you want to go to heaven when you die, all you have to do is accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, believing that he died for your sins and that God raised him from the dead. He lives now and forevermore. He'll come into your heart. He'll be your Savior. That's grace. It's unmerited favor. He'll be your Savior, just like he's ours. Is there one here today that wants to come and accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Now's the time. Now's the time. There could be someone you know you're saved, and you're looking for a church home, and God has led you here. Well, now is your time. You can come by letter. You can come by Christian experience. You can come as a candidate for baptism. Amen. How you come? Now is the time. There's still room. There's still room. Doors of the church are open. Now's the time to come. Saved, now's the time to come. If you're already saved and you're looking for a church home, now's the time to come. Sing it with me, choir. My hallelujah. Sing it with me, choir and congregation. My hallelujah.
Thank you.